and even with themselves on how to move forward and to be the best among others. President John F. Kennedy summarized this mindset in his words, and I quote, "Let us never negotiate out of fear, but let us never fear to negotiate." I believe this is the guiding philosophy behind this book. In a country where politics is driven on the basis of attack, counterattack, and more attack, it takes real commitment for a county governor to reflect on critical national issues and put them in a book. Not tanga tanga, mkileweke. We have to congratulate Professor for this rare achievement that is not wholly unexpected. You've had this tradition of leaders putting their thoughts into books to invite debate. The late Thomas Joseph Mboya, Julius Nyerere, Kwame Nkrumah, Leopold Sedar Senghor, Jomo Kenyatta, Odinga Odinga, just to name a few, all promoted the culture of debate on critical national issues through writing. This pattern of debates, starting over and seeking rebirth, is the story of the USA. It is the story of modern Europe. As we all know, after the brutal Civil War, the USA sought a rebirth that culminated in the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments to the Constitution. The amendments outlawed slavery, made the newly freed slaves American citizens, granted them the right to vote, to defined them the rights between individuals and the state, and for the first time guaranteed the basic equality of all people, no matter their skin color, station in life or citizenship. In Europe, after the numerous ethnic and civil wars that ended up in two world wars, leaders went all out to make certain that there would not be a third war. They agreed Europe must be recognized, reorganized in some sort of federation or union that could blunt the national jealousies and assuage the economic hangers that had been the precursors of both wars. This book and this gathering falls in this great tradition of debate and rebirth. At critical moments in our history, our citizens have got together and debated their future to find a way forward. Bowman's conference was a case in point. I'm glad that in this room, there are men and women who have lived by these broad beliefs and can testify about their necessity. Looking at the challenges the nation is going through, debating and reasoning are going to be critical. Through this book, you're being invited to discuss soberly, honestly, and candidly some of the challenges we face as a country. There's agreement that for far too long, our country has run on the politics of brinkmanship, which now needs to end. And so some of our leaders and citizens are asking, is there a need for amendments to the Constitution of Kenya? If yes, do we go parliamentary or remain presidential? To reintroduce proportional representation at the electoral system, or do we retain the current first past the post simple majority procedure? How do you strengthen and enhance the devolution system? Or are we satisfied with the system as it is today? If, as Professor Michael Chege, my friend, writes in the foreword of the book, Our violent electoral conflicts every 5 years are ever about presidential gold, and seldom or ever about elected positions further down the political hierarchy. And if he has a little tell you Kenyans love to vote for their president, they forget that in 1963, Kenyans voted for a prime minister. And from that time, there were no presidential elections. In 1969, I opposed. 1974, I opposed. 1979, I opposed. 1983, I opposed. 1988, I opposed. So Kenyans voted for the first time for the president in 1992. That is something that those people forget. It's also established that electoral violence is more frequent under presidential regimes than parliamentary regimes. People lose contests for parliamentary or county seats, but it never degenerates into widespread violence or any at all. That's a good enough reason for the country to relook the national executive and fix causes of passionate struggle to win it. And government will tell you, oh, you just want to create more posts for more people. And you're going to include other communities. And yet at the moment you have only two. And if you say you want five, they say that is inclusive. I don't know whether two is bigger or smaller than five. A parliamentary system is viewed as a better way to raise the majority threshold. In a country where tribes view each other with suspicion in the contest for power. Parliamentary system is generally suitable for plural societies. That is, societies in which the political landscape is composed of diverse cultural, religious, ethnic, racial, and regional interests. That is what Kenya is. But it's not just about the executive. They're also struggling with how to ensure national cohesion, provisional sound leadership, and creating institutions that can stand up the nation even under the greatest of the pressures. In a nutshell, you'll be challenged how to re-strategize as a country and start over for the future as many successful nations have done. In our country today, you'll strive to create this forum for reasoned debate through the building bridges to a new Kenyan nation. That team is tackling 9 key areas, including ethnic antagonism and competition, lack of national ethos, inclusivity, devolution, divisive elections, safety and security, and corruption. All these critical questions that require during debate. Unfortunately, such efforts like this by Governor Nyong'o and the BBI are being hindered by the culture of hatred for debate and the preference for fear and fear-mongering. Debate is the tested way to ensure politics of reason overcomes the politics of fear, whose result often is hatred and division, which unfortunately is getting mainstream in this country. And debate is the way to create a well-informed citizenry. As former US Vice President writes in the Assault on Reason, and I quote, "If leaders avoid public fears to hurt people in directions they might not otherwise choose, then fear itself can quickly become a self-perpetuating and free-willing force that drains national will and weakens national character. Diverting attention from real threats, deserving of healthy and appropriate fear, and sowing confusion about the essential choices that every nation must constantly make about the future. As a country, let us not threaten our citizens against debating their future. We must guard against fear-mongering and embrace any effort that encourages debate about our current state and our future. This book is one such effort at the BBI. Now let me now put this into context. As you know, Africa, and I went through a very humiliating experience of colonialism. After the Second World War, the African liberation actually gained steam. Many African countries started to fight for their independence. Here in Kenya, a state of emergency was declared in 1952. Ghana became the first African country to become independent in 1957. Followed by Guinea in 1958. Guinea rebelled from France and said that they preferred freedom in poverty to prosperity in servitude. 1960-59, Harold Wilson was the then Prime Minister, Macmillan, then Prime Minister of Great Britain, made that historical speech in South Africa, the wind of change. He said that the wind of change is blowing, which will result in independence on the most of the colonized countries, not only on the continent, but all over the world. So in 1960, most countries became independent. Nigeria, several others, the French from Africa. These countries were pioneers. In other words, they had no one to learn from. They're all experimenting. In Kenya, our struggle was protracted because of the land ownership that we had in this country, the settler community. And because of this, after the state of emergency was declared, many people were arrested and taken to detentions. Come 1957, what they called the Littleton reforms, Africans were allowed to elect their first leaders for the first time. The first eight leaders were elected. Nyanza South, Nyanza Sabuda, Nyanza Central, Yamango Bingo Dinga, Nyanza North, Masindi Muliro, Rift Valley, Nyanza Ratmoy, Southern Province, Nyanza Mulimi, Central Province, Bernard Martin, Coast, Rangala, and Nairobi, Tambwe. They went to the DECO and formed what we call AEMO, African Elected Members Organization. There are only eight out of a parliament of over 60, maybe 70. There are about 14 Indians, and many, almost 5 or 6 Arabs. So they were completely outnumbered. But then they fought and got an increase of representation from 8 to 14. There they added the Manyaga, Julius Kiano, Francis Hamisi, Mombasa, the Tipis, Taita Toet, and I think a full of movie. So there were now 8, and now they talked about this, a letter written by the political detainees, the 6 Kapenguria detainees, saying, complaining about their conditions of detention. This letter was opposed strongly by the Kenyan government, saying these people are criminals who are tried and convicted by the courts. They are not political prisoners. That was the issue. And then, in the African Elected Members of the Commission meeting, which was being chaired by General Bingo Dinga, they say that
Tom Boyle should raise a motion in Parliament to look at the conditions of people detained. So the motion was brought, and then the debate started. The Ramogas recorded it in his note to Huru, and the chaplain saying a bombshell in the house. When the debate started to continue, the Ramogas stood up. Jeremiah Nyaga would tell us how that day was. But then Jeremiah said that in the heart of hearts of the African people, Jomo Kenyatta and all those who arrested him were and are the true leaders. And their continued detention offends the consciousness of our people. Just like Archbishop Makarios of Cyprus, who was detained in Seychelles, when he was being allowed, when the British government was giving a daily bulletin on his conditions, so should be done with Kenyatta and his team. Nyaga said he could have had a pin drop in the house. They didn't believe that Yanogi would sleep home that night. They thought he was going to be arrested and detained. But he was not arrested. But most of his colleagues disowned him under the pressure from the colonialists. However, Yanogi insisted that he had told the truth, and the rest is history. You can read it, not to whom. Our African put a lot of pressure on the British, and the movement grew up. It started the movement, Kenyatta na Uhuru. The others were saying Uhuru na Kenyatta, but Ramogi said Kenyatta na Uhuru. Until eventually, it became a big nationalist movement that spread all around the country. Kenyatta was released from prison and came and led the nationalist movement. But the British, in practice of their policy of divide and rule, divided the African, the nationalist movement into two groups. How we ended up with Kanu and Kanu. But then independence came. And we came up with a system that was parliamentary. And the elections were held, and Kanu won the elections. Kenyatta became the first prime minister of the country. Yours truly is the second prime minister in the country. So, but thereafter, a development took place in our country. And this is the point I want to make. And it was not just in Kenya, it is something that started across the entire continent of Africa. An idea developed that, because most of these countries inherited multi-party system of independent of governments at independence, and they were parliamentary. The idea developed that the traditional African society is an adversarial system of resolving conflicts that government and opposition did not exist. That in the traditional African society, conflict was resolved by way of a dialogue. People sat down under a tree and dialogued. Sengo called it palaver. Nkrumah was one of the architects of that thinking. Sekou Toure, Mbini, Oliver Keita, Mali, Mwalimu Nyerere, around the corner, even here, Jomo Kenyatta. So efforts were now made to do away with the opposition. So through a series of measures, coercion, intimidation, bribery, blackmail,
the opposition was led into extinction. Single party systems night for the continent. This will be followed in military coups because there was no room for space for opposition and so on. So by the 60s now, Africa found itself under the rules of either single party or military rule. It's the years we describe as the lost years on the continent of Africa. This is what created the African dinosaurs. Monsieur le Président. Is how we created Mobutu Sese Seko, who was a banger of Zaire. Jacques Bedel Bokassa of Central African Republic, which renamed Central African Empire, becoming the other empire after Haile Selassie had been dethroned. The one who would go every Sunday to prison to man flog prisoners. Ngwazi of Malawi, Kamuzu Banda, who would go on a live BBC broadcast and say to his opponents, Chiume and Chipembere, that these are enemies of Malawi. If any of them dare set foot on the territory of Malawi, there will be delicious meals for the crocodiles of the Mozambique. Those are the lost years I'm seeing. And this was playing against the background of the Cold War. So in those days of the Cold War, if you say that you are an ally of the West against the war against communism, nobody cared how you run your affairs. You are tolerated. You're tolerated. And that is how you found that a number of African intellectuals who are not in prison voted by running away into exile. These are years when most of African economies registered negative growth. Because that was the time era of AIDS. A lot of money was being supposedly pumped into the economies, finding its way back into bank accounts in Switzerland, in those foreign countries, leaving these countries impoverished, being described as hippies. So it was not until the Berlin Wall fell that the wind of change that was blowing in Eastern Europe began also to blow in the continent of Africa. The West now discovered a new vocabulary. Transparency, accountability, and good governance. This made it possible for the progressive forces which have been fighting this dictatorial regime for all that period. Space, because now the West also put conditions, the IMF, the World Bank, the pressures came up. Now the constitutional conferences were being held in the places where dictators were being thrown out. And now here, as you know, that many things that happened in this country that I didn't go through. The detentions without trial that was started after, following the murder of Kanu and Kadu, and then the Limuru Conference, and the formation of the KPU, and then the Kisumu fiasco. Then now the leaders were in prison. Then came 71. Then other more people were being arrested and killed. You remember Gugu Demo? You remember Martin Shikuku? Jane Maria Sherone? Joya Nyona? To mention what a few in the second house. Then now came 1982. Because some people said we have one former political party. And we came together to form a political party.
Once this announcement was made, then quickly the end of parliament
and wrote a constitutional amendment to introduce section 2. The arrests are all here, the university here, several lecturers, Kaimati Bachira, Temu Mkangi, my friend, the Dates, Willy Mutunga, my Nyatia, and so on. Then the two happened. The people were using parliament to put the government. Nelson Mandela at his club in California said that I detest violence. There's no space in my heart for violence. I'm against the black discrimination and against white discrimination. But it was only after all the avenues for peaceful change had been closed to us that we decided to answer violence with violence. So in 1982, Section 2 had been brought. What else were the Kenyans to do? Let me not come back to this. In 1990, after us, Dr. Kirito came to see me, to visit me, I came out. I went back, I came out, I went back again. When he came out, this time, they had decided that they were going to form a political party. The Kenya, the National Democratic Party. And it had been refused registration because it was against the constitution. So now, after it has been rejected by the magistrate court, they are now appealed. They went to the court and found James Orengo arguing very strongly that this is a violation of the rights and so on. Then after this, I called Orengo and talked to another friend and said, let us look at this differently. Had a conversation with Orengo, brought the friends together, discussed. The next time we brought Peter, we discussed, we brought Paul, we brought Joe. Initially, those were the first five. And they said that instead of trying to fight in court, so long as you're fighting in court, these people are very comfortable. Let us try to start a movement. And Orengo went and searched the law and found that it's impossible so long as you're not more than nine. So, we then decided that if we just announce this ourselves, it's going to be very easy for Nyayo to pick us up and take us into his response. So let us get the elders, his peers, and that will be the front, and we will be brain behind it. That's how we sought the elders, that's how we brought Senior Muliro, we brought Martin Chikuku, Ande Kamali, we brought the Zenge, we brought Gachoka, I was with Seri Matiba and Mubira. And Jaramogi was the only one who had been with us. You see, Jaramogi was the oldest of the young Turks.
That's how we sat down and then drafted the founding document of Ford, and we announced that Ford had been formed. That's how it was. In the book here, Peter talks of a conversation which is ongoing. That time was basically to peel second to it. And then now Ford took off and captured the imagination of Kenyans. He then brought in Itobu, Manyara, and Mukisa Kitui. So that now formed the group of the Young Turks. And it was like a wildfire. But then it came a stage where again there was a threat to myself, and my colleague decided that I should be out of the country. That's how I got out of the country. They remained, and I opened up an office abroad.